Big thanks to Brilliant for sponsoring this video. This is E.C. George Sudarshan, an Indian-American theoretical physicist who made many significant contributions to the study of small objects in modern physics. One of these contributions was to do with the quantum behavior of light, and many believed he should have won a Nobel Prize for it. Sadly, though, he was overlooked in a rather controversial decision in 2005. Another physicist, Roy J. Glauber, who worked in the same field, was awarded the Nobel Prize instead. That's what we'll talk about in this video. So if you enjoy it, then please hit the thumbs up button, subscribe, and hit that bell for more fun physics content. Let's now talk about George Sudarshan and the Nobel Prize he should have won. George worked in a field of theoretical physics known as quantum optics. This field deals with how photons, the particles that make up light, interact with stuff around them, atoms, molecules, etc. And perhaps his most famous contribution is figuring out a way to use some ideas from a classical theory of electromagnetism, which had been around for over 100 years at that point, to represent and understand the newly developing quantum mechanical idea of coherent states of light using something known as the diagonal representation. Now, we'll understand coherent states and the diagonal representation in a bit more detail later in this video. If you just want to head over straight to the juicy physics-y deets, then head to this timestamp here. Here's an interesting thing though. Roy Glauber initially criticized George on his use of classical electromagnetism within this quantum idea, and therefore George's overall diagonal representation of coherent states. George and Roy therefore discussed back and forth, and eventually Roy agreed with George, even to the point where he supposedly asked George to acknowledge him in George's paper. Roy also published his P representation, which was mathematically equivalent to George's diagonal representation. Now, of course, this is not to say that Roy copied George's work. They were both very successful scientists in the field of quantum optics, and Roy had other very important contributions in the field that worked alongside the Sudarshan-Glauber P representation, as it's now known. Now, before we continue, I want to thank Brilliant for sponsoring this video. The best way to learn anything is by doing it yourself, and Brilliant's interactive, hands-on, and super fun lessons in maths, science, and computer science allow you to do just that. Crucially, they have lots of courses for all ability levels, so you can start off where you feel most comfortable and build from there. I am a firm believer that anyone and everyone can understand STEM subjects well with the help of good learning resources, and Brilliant offers just that, with their clear and intuitive explanations of each topic. I personally have been really enjoying working through a course called Quantum Mechanics with Sabina. I am a huge fan of Sabina Hossenfelder's YouTube channel, and to take part in her quantum mechanics course on Brilliant is a real treat. I'm also looking forward to improving my math skills by taking on courses like group theory and multivariable calculus. Now, if you'd like to check out some of the Brilliant courses on Brilliant, then please click the link in the description box or pinned comment to get started for free. The first 200 of you to click the link will also get 20% off your annual membership. So please do check it out. Huge thanks to Brilliant once again for sponsoring this video. Now let's get back to the 2005 Nobel Prize in Physics. So basically, both George Sudarshan and Roy Glauber made significant contributions to the P representation, with George likely sparking the idea initially. The problem came when Roy was awarded the Nobel Prize for Physics in 2005, but George was not. This was seen as a pretty big oversight, not only by George, but by a group of other physicists who sent a letter to the Swedish Academy responsible for deciding who should win the Nobel Prize. In this letter, they wrote that George being overlooked for the prize was a grave miscarriage of justice. Another letter to the president of the Nobel Committee for Physics also stated that George's work was the first real formulation of the optical theory of coherence for which the prize was awarded. One physicist who worked alongside George actually said that the paper which the Swedish Academy quoted as being the main reason for giving the prize to Roy was reviewed and massively contributed to by George, after which George published his own paper on the topic. George himself weighed in on this topic, saying, "If you give a prize for a building, shouldn't the fellow who built the first floor be given the prize before those who built the second floor?" He also wrote, "No one has the right to take my discoveries and formulations and ascribe them to someone else." Nevertheless, the Nobel Prize stood. bigger controversies have happened with the awarding of this prize, and yet the Swedish Academy sticks with their decisions once they're made. And so it's kind of up to us physics lovers to ensure that George's contribution to this area of physics is appreciated to the same degree as Roy's. Because it's important to point out here that I don't think anyone believes that Roy didn't deserve the prize, or that he should have it taken away from him, but rather that George should have at least been acknowledged to the same level. So why did the Swedish Academy choose to honor Roy, but not George? Well, we don't know the full details, but they did say that Roy published his research first, which was significant, of course, even though George took some of this work to the next level. On top of this, Roy had other work in this field which could be directly attributed just to him, which could have been part of their decision-making process as well. And finally, it's worth mentioning an interesting rule about the Nobel Prize in physics. Alfred Nobel's will clearly states that a maximum of 3 Nobel laureates and 2 different works may be selected for the Nobel Prize in physics. That year, 2 experimentalists were being honored, so there was only 1 other space left, and Roy was given that space. Whatever side you choose to see it from, the Nobel Committee's thinking will be revealed 50 years from the awarding of the prize, so stick around until 2055 to understand their exact reasoning. So now that we understand the story behind the 2005 Nobel Prize in physics, or at least what I personally understand of it, let's take a look at some actual physics. We'll be touching lightly on the work done by both George and Roy, but mostly we'll be understanding exactly what we mean by coherent states in quantum physics. These are the basics of the work that George and Roy both contributed to. In order to do this, though, we'll have to start in an altogether more familiar place. Let's start with a mass attached to a spring, oscillating back and forth. If we ignore any air resistance or other forms of friction within the system, then this mass spring system will just keep bouncing back and forth forever. The reason we're starting with this system is because its potential energy looks exactly like what we want to be studying. Specifically, we can plot out the potential energy because of the spring's extension and compression at each point as the mass moves back and forth. And when we do, we find that it looks like a parabola, or a y is equal to x squared curve. In this case, it's the potential energy that's proportional to x squared, where x represents the position of the mass away from the central position, where the spring is at its natural length. This kind of system, one that experiences a quadratic potential energy, or in the shape of a parabola, is known as a classical harmonic oscillator. Another example of this is a pendulum swinging back and forth, if the swings are generally quite small in angle away from the equilibrium position. Classical harmonic oscillators are very useful systems to study, because there are also quantum mechanical versions of this. On the small scale, atoms or other particles going about their business may come across a region of space where the potential energy is quadratic. This potential energy could come about due to electromagnetic forces exerted by other charged particles or objects around our main particle, or any other forces that may act in the region. Doesn't really matter. In fact, quite often, when we study regions where there's a varying potential energy landscape, the parts where there is a minimum can be closely approximated by quadratic potential. The smaller the region we consider, the better this approximation becomes, generally speaking. And regions where the potential is minimum are interesting to study, because from a classical physics perspective, we know that particles tend to move towards lower energy states. That's why there's a joke amongst quantum physicists that everything worth studying is a quantum harmonic oscillator. So, a quantum harmonic oscillator can be thought of as any system, for example, a particle, that experiences a quadratic potential well. But the difference between the quantum harmonic oscillator and the classical one that we looked at earlier is that the classical one could be found with any energy value in this potential well. It just depended on how far we stretched the spring before letting it go. However, in the quantum case, we only ever find our system in specific energy levels, evenly spaced along the potential well. These energy levels are commonly labeled using a letter N, which just tells us which energy level we're talking about. The N is equal to 0 level is the lowest, then N is equal to 1, then 2, then so on. What this means is that we will never ever find our system with an energy anywhere between any 2 of the allowed energy levels. More on this idea in my quantum physics videos. Check one of them out up here, which will also be linked in the description box. Now, as it turns out, George Sudarshan and Roy Glauber's work essentially use this concept of a quantum harmonic oscillator to describe electromagnetic fields and specifically light, which we classically think of as an electromagnetic wave. This work states that light can be thought of as being in a very specific mix of multiple energy states together, if the system that we're studying is actually the electromagnetic field. When we think of a light wave, we can think of it as being made up of this specific blend or superposition of many different energy states of the electromagnetic field. If you want to find out more about this weird quantum mechanical superposition idea, then check out this video, again, also linked in the description. So let's back up for a second. What the heck are we actually talking about? What do these energy states even represent, and what does it have to do with the electromagnetic field, or rather the quantized electromagnetic field? Well, interestingly, this is where we link classical electromagnetic waves and quantum mechanical photons, or think about it in terms of wave-particle duality. Because each state that we're talking about, or specifically the number n used to represent each state, actually represents the number of photons traveling through space corresponding to the wave that we're studying. Basically, what I'm saying is that a classical electromagnetic wave can be thought of as a system which is made up of a very specific blend of different states, where each state represents a specific number of photons. In other words, our system could be made up of one photon, or two photons, or three photons, or four photons. In fact, it's made up of all of these possibilities in a very specific mix of each possible state. And when we make a measurement to find out the number of photons corresponding to our wave, then the system collapses into one of these states. We find out that, for example, there are four photons. But before the measurement, the system was actually made up of just one photon and exactly two photons and exactly three photons and so on. This strange idea is once again quantum mechanical. Surprise, surprise. It's known as the collapse of the wave function. More on that up here or linked in the description. Now, as always, this is a pretty oversimplified description of the physics, but it gives us a good picture of what's going on in this rather mind-boggling theory, worked on by the two brilliant scientists that we've focused on in this video, as well as others. So, if you enjoyed this video, then please hit the thumbs up button, subscribe, and hit that bell button for more fun physics content. Check out my merch, it features a quantum dice design based on a famous quote from Albert Einstein. And finally, a huge thanks to all of my Giga patrons and all of the others over on my Patreon page. That's linked down below in the description as well if you'd like to support me on there. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you very soon.